Yes, sir. Huh?
There you go. There you go.
There you are, right there. Hi, how are you? Nice to see you. Good. We're all back.
That's what happens when you get like 4 days. I don't think I've taken 4 days where I haven't like done a show or written 15,000 words. So taking Thursday and Friday off was much appreciated. But welcome back, everybody. Thanks, guys. Thanks for Thursday. Thanks for Friday. Lochlin Cross is here. Ryan Lindley is here as well. Really appreciate it. I needed it. I needed to recharge. It was Christmas time. I had to go do like things with human beings. And to the point where I was like, on Wednesday, we finished the show and I'm like, I don't think I ever want to do this stuff again. Like you were getting that.
I went to like the farmer's market.
Did you really on Friday? On Thursday?
On Saturday. Thursday. My mother-in-law is in town, so we went to the farmer's market. I've never been. I'm a fan.
They got some good stuff.
Oh, farmers markets are the best. And that's the thing, right? You're at that age where it's like, it's not nerdy to go and do that kind of stuff, right?
Isn't it?
No, the farmers market. But we live in this, like, I find that I have been, ever since the pandemic started, it's like 3 years, all I've been doing is working. It's like 15, 16-hour days. It's like, I'm pretty sure my screen time last month was 16 hours a day. It's not fair, right? It's just a stupid thing to do. I'm an idiot. This is like, what do you want? It's like Twitter. You're on Twitter for 5 hours a day. I'm like, this is fucking ridiculous. I got off this.
No problem. So,
yeah, it's like when you get the referendum from your phone, it's like, get outside, you dumb fuck. And I'm like, all right. So I took like Thursday, Friday off. So Thursday, all the boys and I go get like Christmas haircuts, right? Like just, well, it's tis the season. You're walking through the mall, the music's playing. It's like, I'm getting into Christmas. I'm like, fuck, that was so much fun. We shopped all day. I'm like, I'm going to take fucking Friday off. Now, as someone who has been working just to eat for the past 3 years, and being in a position where it's like, oh, you can actually go and enjoy your day. It was so fucking foreign to me. Right. So I'm like,
feels weird.
No, I'm going to get it. So I went out and did Christmas shopping and did all that other stuff the next day as well. So as someone who leaves all the Christmas shopping to the very last fucking second, all the time, it's like the last week you zip in, you zip out, nothing thoughtful, none of that stuff. I'm almost done my Christmas shopping. Friday rolls around. Saturday, I get an invite to watch a few Hallmark movies. And I'm like, I'm doing it. I'm watching Hallmark movies this weekend because I enjoyed being a douchebag, Christmas douchebag on Thursday. Yep. I enjoyed being a Christmas douchebag on Friday. Yep. I'm going to be a Christmas douchebag on Saturday.
And Lochlin can shit on it all he wants, but those farmers markets that you're talking about that are all Christmassy, it's like being in a Hallmark fucking Christmas movie, Lochlin.
Bingo. Bingo. If you haven't watched one,
there's so many things I want to say right now.
You're not going to talk until I'm done
about your sexuality.
No.
that I know will not go over well.
So,
Lachlan doesn't like to make his Yuletide gay.
Okay. Saturday, I go down to Yorkville.
Yeah,
for
you
the
went
Christmas
down.
Tree lighting ceremony. And I had a great time. We went shopping. I got a hot cocoa. We watched them light the tree in Canada's richest, ritziest neighborhood. And I was like, I'm in the fucking mood for Christmas for the first time in like fucking 3 years.
Yeah, good for you. That's good.
I got candy canes on the fucking tree. Then yesterday was the piece de resistance. By the way, we've got a bunch of Elon Musk stuff to get to, the Emergency Act hearing. We're going to make fun of those fuckers again. So hang in there for us. We got a few things to get to. It's Christmas season. We're starting off a little Christmas season.
And Hallmark movies.
Well, we will. And I'm getting there. So relax, because it was a lot of fun.
Tinsel up your ass.
Tinsel up your ass. If Lachlan, I could fart tinsel, I might. I'm into Christmas this year. So
I put a full container of tinsel in my bum.
So yesterday, a friend of mine, she's like, let's watch Hallmark movies. I saw you making fun of
Hallmark. Oh, was this Vivian?
So, yep. So she's like, we got to watch Hallmark movies. So I'm like, all right. So we sit down, watch one Hallmark movie. And I'm like, that was fucking awesome. That was incredible.
Mm-hmm. No, I want to watch another one. Stop it, dude.
It's unbelievable.
Stop it.
Then I watch the second. Then I watch the third.
Sucked into them.
Not only do you get sucked into it, there's something in it for us too. In each one of these Hallmark movies, okay, let me go through the fucking formula. There's a fucking formula, and it's for everybody. In each one of these Hallmark movies, here's how it works. Really, really simple. There's a widow. And the widow always has a kid, right?
Yeah.
So you got a dead mom or a dead dad. boom, Dean's hooked already. How did the mom die? How did the dad die? I'm like asking
need to
all
know.
These questions while we're sitting in the movie.
The bus.
Was it a, they always was it get a grain auger accident? Yeah, did they drown? Did the car go through the ice? Like I
last year's Christmas parade.
Yeah.
Tragedy.
Yeah. So I'm sitting there watching it.
It was a bomb tinsel accident. We don't really want to get into it.
We've lost mom 2 years now. She was boofing tinsel.
Yep.
Candy cane dildo gone wrong?
She had a candy cane dildo. She's dead anyway. There's a movie about it called Mr. Hands. Don't worry about it. But there's a widow. There's a kid of the widow.
Yeah.
And then there's a significant love interest. Now, the widow might be a dude. It might be a woman. Usually it's a dude, and he's got a little girl with him because they really want to tug the fucking heartstrings, right?
Yeah.
The kid a shithead every time? Like the kid just is off the rails, all the kid, doing crack in the basement.
No. The kid wants mom or dad to be happy. Kid is doing everything they can.
That's a real fucking Christmas story.
Santa already
teenager gets hooked on crack, steals the car, and starts stripping. Yeah, like that's a real story.
Oh, that is a fucking normal Christmas in the real world.
That's your Hallmark movie right there.
But that's why they make these Hallmark movies, is to take people out of their real lives. And it's like,
oh, she meets somebody with a little bit of money to get her out of the trailer park, her and her kid. They got a Doberman tied to the back of the Trans Am.
It's got a silver choke chain on it. It's got scars. You're right. In the real world, but Dean's right.
So they're just burning their shit in the living room. That's a real fucking story. That's the one I want to watch as soon as they write that one.
Dad's not dead. He's in jail.
Yeah, so he's in the jail.
Everyone's an alcoholic.
This is Christmas in the act.
Love interest. It's the best because the love interest in these is
always Friday
like,
night. They have fights in the back of the local pub with all right. for cigarettes.
Can I finish the Hallmark formula, please?
I just wrote you a Hallmark movie.
You're writing, the Alberta Hallmark movie. That's what you're writing. If that's the Hallmark movie in Alberta, that'd be the number one movie in Alberta. It'd be the fucking Elf of Alberta.
You know how they fell in love? She came to his rescue when he got shot.
In some kind of meth
that
robbery.
That back alley cigarette fight.
Anyway.
Got a little ugly and he took one in the shin.
Anyway. So the love interest comes to town and it's all set in this beautiful town in Vermont called Evergreen.
Oh,
and there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 Evergreen movies. Christmas in Evergreen. And Evergreen is the fucking Bermuda Triangle of Christmas. Everyone that goes there is like super fucking sad, trying to get away from life. They promised their kid the best Christmas. And magically, a hot chick or a hot dude who just has this fucking major life crisis goes to Evergreen to get it together, to do some writing. And then they meet.
All this works in mind as well.
And then the kid is promised the best Christmas ever. And so it's only now the best Christmas ever if the love interest stays with the widow, because the kid wants the love interest to like mom or dad. And it always happens the same way. Every single time they get together, someone gets on a plane or they get to the airport or they get in their car to leave because they've misunderstood someone's intentions. And all of a sudden the car breaks down or it runs out of gas or the plane actually can't take off because there's mechanical problems. So they all make their way back to the Bermuda Triangle of Christmas, Evergreen, Vermont. Yeah. And they get stuck there because all of a sudden Dr. Bellamy and Allie have fallen in love at a barn Christmas dance. It's unbelievable. You can't get enough of this stuff. Yeah. And here's what they do. They do spinoffs.
It's like Viv's number. We need to limit the time he spends with her.
It was
clearly went from Twitter to this.
And here's the best part. They got Easter eggs in there for guys like us. Like Allie, she walks up to a tree, grabs a couple of ornaments and goes, "These balls are magnificent. Are they hand blown?" And I'm like,
"No, we didn't."
Oh, dude. And it's littered with little kind of off centered, out of context, dirty jokes. Like there's this one dude who shows up to go skating and he's flamboyantly fun, but he's the love interest's best friend, gay best friend. And he goes out there skating. Right. And they played up the ephemeral attitude of this guy to the point where he goes out skating and he jumps around. And they're like, "He's the best, isn't he?" And they go, "Look at him. he stole a fucking kid and started skating off the ice with him. And I'm like, oh, there's kidnapping in this one. This is unbelievable.
Groomer! Groomer! No, I'm convinced. I'm convinced that Hallmark Christmas movies were actually invented by the porn industry as like a workers' comp return to work thing. You know, if they injure themselves in a porn and they can't do porn anymore, the acting is on that level. Like it's so
really
you get sucked into it. It's so bad. It's so good. It's so bad. It's good.
Yeah, but you follow the storyline and I'm following it and I'm trying to figure out the formula, and it's so formulaic to the point where Lochlin, to your point, I'm sitting there thinking, what aren't they capturing? How unrealistic is this? Like, you know, Allie and Dr. Bellamy ended up together. We don't see Allie crushing sleeping pills at night before she goes to bed because Dr. Bellamy came into the marriage with a fucking major drinking problem. We don't
and
see
herpes. Any of that.
And a pre-signed script pad. She's been writing her own scripts from his pad.
Honey, I gave you a gift for Christmas. What is it? You'll find out in 3 weeks or when you get really stressed. Yeah, you don't see
you know what? That stuff. I can't. I won't be able to do that. I just.
Oh, you have to, dude.
You know,
you do it and drink. It's one of the
even,
fucking
I can't
greatest
even do Marvel movies
of my life.
Because of how formulaic they are. Like, just it's the same shit.
Gotta watch it.
Did you notice how
wear on me?
How they've changed? I don't know. Is this your first year into this foray?
Hallmark movies? Yeah, dude. Yeah. I've been mocking them for years.
Right. I'm like, cool. Sound like it.
Okay.
It doesn't sound like it's your first year.
This is the first year that I've noticed. Formula. You want to talk about that formula? Part of that formula now is the inclusivity formula. So now it's a white guy and a white girl. Then it's a black guy and a black girl. Then it's a gay couple. Then it's a black and white guy and a black and white girl.
Interracial, yeah.
It's almost like they do it on a consistent loop that way. Like you don't see like five of them with like black couples, and then you don't see five of them with white couples. It's always... Yeah, there you go.
That's the formula. This is the
formula.
You can see
it.
And then they'll introduce like Holly Robinson Pete is in it, and she'll fall in love with someone and like kind of fall in love with someone in half an episode. And then in the next episode, it's all about the black couple. And the next episode, it's all about the interracial couple. But they're like, everyone is a spinoff, right?
Yeah.
And to your point, Lochlin, they're fucking terrible. They're the worst movies you'll ever watch. But if you're watching them because you think they're great movies, you're an idiot. That's my
point.
Well,
they're so bad, they're good.
Oh, awesome. I can see why you would do it for comedy, right? Like,
oh, it is.
Smoke a bowl and sit down and watch.
We should live tweet them.
The thing about the, have you guys heard any interviews? Because Quentin Tarantino has a book out, so he's been doing a lot of press. So everyone's getting him to dip his toes into the more controversial side of Hollywood. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of interesting because he's not wrong. He was like, he's talked about how it's arrogant. Sounds very arrogant, but he's talked about how he gets away with things that other people don't get away with. So no one sits him down and goes, I don't see an Asian character here. He just gets to do what he gets to do, right? Because he makes bazillion dollars when he releases anything. Mm-hmm. But he made an interesting point. He goes, I've been doing this forever. I've always had inclusivity in my movies. He goes, if I wanted a black guy in the movie, I wrote a black guy in the movie. If I wanted an Asian character, I wrote an Asian character. If I wanted a Mexican, I wanted a Mexican. No one forced me to do that. And he said, I think we will get back to a time where there isn't this pressure put on people that are creating content to be automatically inclusive. It'll go back. And he also said, we also will get to a point where Marvel movies stop being a thing. He said real directors are sitting there waiting for that shoe to drop and that to stop, to go away, which I thought was kind of interesting.
Yeah, it's super interesting, dude. And I would agree with it. Like I watched, have you finished Andor? Andor was fucking incredible, by the way. It's so good.
You know what was interesting about Andor to me was I didn't feel like I was watching a Star Wars
thing. Not me neither.
And that was why I enjoyed it. And it didn't follow the traditional sort of path of the Star Wars franchise, right? And I mean, I'm not enough of a fan to sit here and give you the formula. but mm-hmm. you know it when you're watching it. You just know it intuitively. And that's exactly why I think Andor has been as successful and is successful with people that just like good entertainment. I honestly wasn't going to watch it because I watched, what was it? The Mandalorian was okay. I think it got a little bit more hype than it needed. And then it,
you didn't like Obi-Wan, did you? You weren't a big Obi-Wan fan. No.
I really disliked it.
Yeah.
And I didn't like the Boba fetish. Like, to me, that was like, And then when the Obi-Wan came out, like the Mexican Jedi, I was just like, with a Scottish accent, I'm like, what are we doing here? Like, why? Like, why am I watching this?
Yeah, but part of that is you shit on things because it's fun to shit on things. You and I both know that. It's way more fun to shit on things, especially when you don't give them a chance. That's why you're shitting on these Hallmark movies. You shit on the Hallmark movies because you haven't watched them.
You're shitting on them. You just said they're the worst things ever made, but you're
totally.
You're trying to talk me into ever made.
Yeah, you got to watch it. You got to you and the wife got to sit down on like a Saturday night and give it a chance, because I'm not watching it because I think, oh, this is going to be a great movie and I can't wait to see a great love story and maybe there'll be kissing or maybe a caress or maybe I'll get to see a great ass shot or something when someone bends over to pick up like a nutcracker or some side boob. I'm not watching it for those reasons. I'm watching it because I want to know what the phenomenon is. Like, I want to know exactly what people are talking about. And so we take these hardline positions where we're like, dude, I made fun of Hallmark movies last week, probably four times. And so I got a challenge. And he's like, you got to watch them, but you can't watch them for the same reasons that other people watch them, right? Like, I don't want to generalize, but I imagine women watch Hallmark movies for very different reasons than guys do. Guys watch Hallmark movies because they're like, this is fucking incredible. It's the same movie every time, just with different people, and it's the same result, right? Whereas people are getting sick of the Marvel movies for that very same fucking reason, right? Same outlandish bullshit, trying to tie in different things, and you get tired of it. You're like, there's so many fucking universes to follow. With the Hallmark movies, there's one universe to follow. The Bermuda Triangle of Christmas in Evergreen, Vermont. That's it. And then you get to watch people make fools out of themselves. You got to watch it with Deb one weekend. Plus, you'll get into the Christmas season. Yeah, you will. Trust me, you will. I'm telling you, you will. You're going to get into the Christmas season.
I'll find other ways of getting into the Christmas season. We went speaking of Christmas shopping, mm-hmm. we went and bought some stuff because I'm not putting lights up this year.
Atta boy.
Because I said, I'm not going to do it. I said, I need to get a proper ladder. I don't want to do this in the snow. And it's like, mm-hmm. I said, we just moved in like 3 weeks ago. And she said, no problem. I said, but I got an idea. Why don't we go to Canadian Tire and we'll buy some of those like outdoor, you know, displays or whatever. Mm-hmm. So, we went to Canadian Tire and bought a couple of like birch trees that light up. So that's how I get. And then I bought some alcohol. I got this Bailey's, like this distillery, this local distillery made this Bailey's and dropped it off at the radio station. And I had some of my coffee. Holy shit.
Is it awesome? It's the one thing I miss about Christmas is the drinking. Like, it's like this fucking, it's like open season for alcohol at Christmas, right?
So good.
And it's like everybody gets a chance to get wasted. Everybody.
Even people that don't normally drink usually drink pretty good.
I know. And fancy these guys too. Right.
This local distillery, I'll find out their name. I'm trying to remember it right now. They just dropped it off, and I just basically grabbed it and put it in the fridge. But it's like homemade Bailey's, and it's the best thing I've ever had. I put it in my coffee, and then I was like, I can drink this straight, and I did.
I have an amaretto problem at Christmas every year. It's amaretto, Di Serrano, and
really.
Bailey's and Kahlua. I usually get like eggnog, and Kahlua. You call it a muddy omelet. You can get absolutely just tanked on those.
Eggnog things. And Kahlua. Thank
you. Oh my God, it's so good.
The muddy omelet.
Muddy omelet.
Yeah. So good.
I went to. Nah, it wasn't Hanson's. No, it wasn't Hanson's. It's another one. Somebody just posted on the side there what it might have been. It's not them. I got it there. It's called Thick and Dirty. This Bailey's.
Nice.
I almost bought a thing at Kahlua today. I was at the Costco liquor store getting my re-upping on my 48 pack. But I mean, I don't know.
Make sure you get the new one. It's a salted caramel.
You fancy bastard.
Yeah.
So what do you do? Stuff. You put that in your coffee like
with a little cream, or do you just put it in by itself? And how much how much booze are you putting in that coffee?
You it's put probably a good you got to you got to cut Kahlua. Yeah, you got to cut it with something. It's got to be some kind of drink.
Yeah, vodka. It's called a Black Russian. Grow up. It's.
That's vodka Kahlua. That's a Black Russian.
Yeah. We literally, I love all the.
You know you're an alcoholic, by the way.
Does Costco have a liquor vodka store?
Yeah, I had no idea. I was in Costco this weekend.
Yeah.
Worst experience of my fucking life. Worst experience of my fucking life.
Yeah, I saw your tweet. What happened?
Well, it's a sim. Costco's a sim.
A sim.
It is. It's like, hey, if you can survive this, you can survive anything. Just go in and see what happens. So I go in to renew my card. Go with my son. He's like, he really wants to go to Costco, get protein shakes. He's like a workout weirdo. He's like, we need the protein shakes. I got to get the fucking, the premier protein. New premier. I'm like, whatever. We'll go get premier protein.
Sounds like my daughter.
And he's like, but we got to go.
$60 bucket of something. And
yeah, protein. There's a $140 bag of protein. He's like, I need this too. I'm like, whatever. So anyway, he's like, we can only get it at Costco. So I go, okay, we need to renew the card. That's why I go in, stand in line. This woman, she's like, she goes to me, she goes like this. I go, you want me to come up to the kiosk? She goes like this. And I go, hi, I'd like to renew my card. She's like, yes, please. I go, what? She's like, yes, please. I go, no, I just want to renew my card. So I give her my driver's license. She looks at me, smiles, takes my driver's license, puts it on the keyboard, and then sits there with her head down and doesn't move. Doesn't move for 5 minutes. Doesn't move. I'm like, ma'am, are you okay? She goes, I don't know. I go, okay, great. So she leaves, comes back with my license another 5 minutes later. She does the same thing again. And I'm like, ma'am, are you okay? She's like, I don't know. She leaves, comes back again. Now I'm realizing that they've hired this woman and she doesn't speak great English, like at all, and doesn't really understand and doesn't really even know what she's doing. After like 20 minutes of standing at this kiosk, just saying, I just want to give you $67 so I can renew my card. That's it. That's all I want to do. And she goes, okay, come. So she brings me around to the other side where all the employees.
Tell me she put her fingers in your ears.
No, she didn't. She goes, you do. I go, what are you talking about? She goes, you do.
No.
So I go, you want me to fill out all my stuff on the Costco like software computer kiosk? That like I'm not an employee, but I will if you want me to. I know how to do it. She's like, yeah, I don't know. She says again. So I get back there, take my coat off. My son's on the other side of the kiosk, killing himself laughing. I'm like, do 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 do. I fill in all my information.
Oh my God.
Give myself a free card. I go the thing. I print it off. She's like, good, thank you very much. Then the printer won't
work. She doesn't even work there.
This is the best part. So the printer won't work. There's someone standing behind my son. My son goes, go ahead. So the person comes up. It's like, yeah, I need to renew my card. I go, no problem. Just need your driver's license, your Costco card, please.
No, you did not. Great. You got to stop going out.
I love it.
I worked at Costco for 5 minutes because the person that was working there couldn't speak or understand the language and asked me if I would help her. And I'm like, I'll give it my fucking best.
Why not?
And then the fucking manager of the membership area goes, dude, you can't be here. I go, she asked for my help. What do you want from me?
I didn't put her there.
That was my Costco experience. I will never fucking go back. That's the other thing. I love Costco. I love the idea of Costco, but it's legitimately a sim. Like there should be a video game where you get a reward at the end of it for getting out of there without yelling at somebody or punching someone out or saying, can you move your fucking cart? Cause I have to get in the freezer. Like it's just the worst place in the world.
It's that membership gives everybody entitlement.
You went on the weekend. That's a huge mistake. You can't do the weekend. Cause it's like an outing for like, a lot of families. Like I've never understood that. I got a couple of rules about kids. One, don't take them to Costco, and two, don't travel with them until they're 13 unless you drug them. And if you drug them, you can take them to Costco. And I don't understand why you have to drag your entire like herd out to Costco. They're running around. Everyone's driving around with a 400-pound cart. I'm surprised there isn't more fatalities, to be brutally honest with you,
in Costco.
At Costco. It's leave your kids at home.
Maybe more fatalities. I don't know if they've been.
Or just
any
put them
fatalities.
In the car. Just throw a lighter into the back seat. You don't
There's
need
no
the
way
car running.
There's no way there hasn't been a fatality there. Multiple. I agree. I hate that place. I can't stand it. Like in the on hours, like in off hours, I get what you're saying. Like if you go on like on a Tuesday,
I went this morning. Like right after we got off. After
that's
after
9
we get
o'clock
up the,
in
off
the
air.
Morning, though, dude.
10 o'clock in the morning.
You got a great life. You can go at that time.
That is nice.
That's the way to go. That's when I do my Costco shopping, unless it's desperate and I have to make my way down there. Like if I'm really out of beer and I got to get a 48 pack, I'm not going down there until Saturday or Sunday on a Saturday or Sunday. Just not.
Do you guys enjoy Twitter this weekend? Anybody? Hands up if you enjoyed Twitter a little bit this weekend.
I'm on Twitter. I don't know if I follow Twitter like you guys do. Like, what's it doing that it doesn't normally do?
It was okay. I was kind of preoccupied with video editing. I was like a hermit in the basement for most of the weekend doing that. But
doing the cheese boutique stuff.
Yeah.
For Afrin.
Yeah. Coming along. And but I did see a couple of things from our new chief twit or whatever he's calling himself.
I had to mute him.
Did you?
I had to mute him because he's like one of the most annoying followers on Twitter now. Like, all he fucking does is whine. Like every day he whines about something, lies about what he's whining about. Like he's case in point. This is what he did this morning. He's like, this is my bedside table, which I think it is. He's got a fake gun. He's got a $130 PBS replica gun that you can buy online of George Washington's flintstock pistol. He's got some kind of Indian amulet that's supposed to shoot like mental lightning at people. And then he's got four empty cans of caffeine-free Diet Coke. This bothered people because of the guns. Who cares? I don't even care about the guns.
There's not even a trigger on the fucking thing.
No, there's no trigger on the toy gun. And it's a flintstock gun. It's not even real.
Yeah.
What bothers me about this are the fucking Diet Cokes and all the coaster marks all over that fucking side table, if that is indeed his side table. I have no reason to believe it's not. But, like, what kind of fucking animal?
A slob. Well,
doesn't use a fucking coaster. Seriously. Well,
normally it's Mountain Dew all over mom's coffee table. He's just upgraded to a marble top, I guess, with Diet Coke.
Isn't that like when you see there are a few things in this life where I go, you're insane. And they're really innocuous things.
Yep.
Like ruining a table with multiple coaster marks means you hate life. If you don't put your shopping cart away, you hate this world. You're a selfish cock. You just are. If you have a dirty floor or you wear your shoes in the house, same thing. These are surefire ways to tell if the person you're dealing with is literally a psychotic
psycho.
Never boil it down to that.
But. Yeah, seriously. Those are and the coaster. Like if you look at this fucking table and the world is like everybody's going, that's an anti-Semitic tweet. No, it's not. That this guy's a fuck. He is anti-Semitic, but whatever. This guy's promoting gun violence. Whatever. It isn't. People are stupid. It doesn't matter. He's done a bunch of other anti-Semitic stuff in the last couple weeks. This is the least anti-Semitic. This is just like when I saw this, I'm like, oh my god, this is like I'd imagine what every incel's night table looks like. Right?
Yeah.
A couple of guns, fake ones that don't work, just feel cool. Some empty Diet Coke cans, coaster marks all over the place. Some kind of like Indian amulet that he thinks shoots lightning. And that's where he camps out at night. Those are the things that are important to him. Just to look cool. Just to kind of feel cool.
We went through the Forbes billionaire list. Mm-hmm. And the thing that I was kind of shocked about, because it was like the top 50 or 51 the richest people in the world. A lot of people from France, but I was going through the list just to see how many names I recognize. And you'll be surprised. You will not recognize that many. I think there was only one Canadian, like a family in there. But the thing that I was kind of, I guess I shouldn't be shocked about, but it just, they all looked like they don't get a lot of exercise. And they all looked like they collectively put him in like an oven, like a walk-in oven, and like left him in there a little too long. And they're all like, it's the list of people that are billionaires that have all this money and this power. It's a pretty pathetic. Like, I understand we all hate Elon Musk, but you should go look at the list. There's very few people that I don't know. I guess I was looking for someone that you could go
normal.
There's a like, look at her, like, oh, look at him. Like, that's a guy that if he was standing on the stage telling how he got rich, I'd be like, but no, there's none of that. These people with money, however they come about getting their money, whether they deserve it or not, or it was passed down on the family and they're just maintaining it and they're good at maintaining it, whatever it is, none of these people are any different than just the rest of us.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, remember that group picture of those people from that crypto place that got busted there last week or 2 weeks ago? That
FTX, entire, yeah.
Yeah. That entire group of FTX that looked like a group home photo.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
And they're all billionaires.
You're right. I mean, you think about the list. Like, if you look at the Forbes list, and it's a fascinating list. You bring it up. Elon's number one on the list, $219 billion. Not Bezos, relatable. Jeff Bezos, wow. Number two, $171 billion. Not relatable. And then the French family, the Arnauds. No idea who they are. Bill Gates, not relatable. $129 billion. Warren Buffett. He might be the most relatable guy on this whole list. He's number five. Like, he still stops at McDonald's and lives in the same house he lived in for the past like 4 years. He still pays with exact change that his girlfriend gives him before he leaves the house, and he never gets anything different. He's got the same office that he's had for the past 50 years. He's got the same plastic
drives a
table.
Toyota Corolla or something?
Yeah.
Yeah. And he came from that thing. Yeah. Like, he is actually a self-made rich man, you know. So
I don't know much about the billionaires, but from what I remember, he's self-made. From the invest, like, he just invested, right?
Yeah, like, he doesn't do it. He started a newspaper route, and then he's selling candy, and he was like, if you keep rolling that money over, investing it into different things, I'm gonna have more money than everybody else if I get to a certain age. And to him, he was like a math whiz, right? So to him, it's a game. Like he said, I've never really even cared about the money. Like, I don't care that I'm one of the richest guys in the world.
Yeah.
To me, it's like, I want to be the guy that everybody puts their money with, and I want to win on the stock market. I don't really care about anything else. Don't care about the money. He cares about the W's. That's what makes him relatable, right? Yeah. At least it does to me. But
it's interesting too, these guys with money as well, quite often, in downturns in economy and things like that, they still maintain their wealth, or they double it or triple it or whatever. Right. And I'm just like, never take advice from a billionaire. Like, Bezos is like, you know what? There's a downturn in the economy. Better not buy a car. I'm like, fuck you. I'm going to buy four. Like, you're such a cop.
Doing it despite him.
Don't tell me what to do, because you need me to play your little game. That's how you got rich. You got rich on the backs of all the other assholes that like floated you money. Like, so the last person I am taking any advice from is anybody with money, because they're just looking to screw you. That's the basis, the entire concept behind cryptocurrency. In my understanding of it, is just, it's gonna be this.
Yeah.
Every time I hear anybody talk about fucking crypto, all I hear them say is, it's going to be this. You got to hang in there. It's going to be this. It's going to be this. It's going to be this. You're going to look back at this day when you didn't do this, and you're going to go, I should have done that. And you know who's benefiting from that? A fucking handful of people. And everyone else is getting absolutely screwed by cryptocurrency. Mm-hmm. Right? Like,
dude, the richest guy, if you do the Forbes list and you go to Canada, so you can do it by country, richest guy in Canada is a guy named Chang Peng Zhao. Chang Peng Zhao is number 19 on the overall list of the world's most rich people. He's the first Canadian on the list. $65 billion cryptocurrency exchange, CZ. That was the guy that outed the FTX exchange guys.
Right.
He's a Canadian, right? His name's CZ. Second richest
guy. And next
year,
he won't even be on the list, and he'll be bankrupt.
He's going to be zeroed out. Yeah.
Yeah.
David Thompson, the Thompson family, $49.2 billion. That's a lot of fucking money. He owns the Jets too, by the way. Jimmy Pattison, $12 billion. David Cheriton at number four. What does he do? Google guy.
There's a lot of Google money.
Oh fuck, Google is like three or four of the guys here in Canada. But generally, people that you've never heard of are the richest people in Canada, which is kind of fascinating.
I think there's a couple of types of rich there's the narcissist that wants everybody to know his name. Like Elon Musk's he wants everybody to know his name, right? Jeff Bezos desperately just wants everybody to like him. And then there's the quiet billionaires that are like, no, I know what I did to get here. I screwed you all. The less you know about me, the better. Put a picture up of my business. Put a picture up of the sign of my restaurant.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Instead it's fascinating, dude. Like, it's that's why, like, the stuff that he's doing today is so fucking off. Like, he's trying to pick a, this is what, to your point, like, he's got no understanding how life works. He's trying to threaten Apple and Tim Cook today. Like, I couldn't believe it. And he's not stopping. It's like, this guy is all over it. Apple has almost stopped advertising on Twitter. He's pissed off that Apple's like, we're not going to give you any money because you platform a bunch of anti-Semites and anti-LGBTQS people.
Man, so Apple used to spend
millions
a lot
of
money.
Huge cash.
Millions a month on Twitter.
When they were doing a launch, Dean, that's all you'd see on Twitter. Is their new phone? You
couldn't get away from it. Yeah, they'd own Twitter. You're right. Yeah. So he's like, do they, and he's fucking, this is kind of the part about him that leads into that entitlement, you know, the billionaire, like, you've got no idea what's going on in the real world. Apple's mostly stopped advertising on Twitter. Do they hate free speech in America? No. They have a monopoly. Weird. You can hate them all you want. And that's another reason I don't like Apple, the monopoly on what apps survive and what don't, but it doesn't matter. It's a private fucking exchange. They can do whatever the fuck they want. So he doubled down on that, and he's been doing this all day. Saying Apple has also threatened to withhold Twitter from its app store, but won't tell us why. We know why. Like, and then he does a poll. Like, he's taken on the richest company in the world and maybe the most powerful tech company in the world by far.
Mm-hmm.
Apple could publish all censorship actions as it taken effects to its customers. Yes or no? This is like 20 minutes ago. It had 300,000 votes, and he did it like 25 minutes ago. And the whole goal is to try and pressure Apple into not dropping Twitter from its app store, and they can do whatever the fuck they want. Like, even I understand that.
And is that a possibility?
It's not just Twitter that's talking about it. Apple is talking about it. Google is talking about delisting the
Google Play Store. Yeah.
The Google Play Store and Apple. If that gets removed, he's fucked to the
point. Did you hear
what
he said he wants to do? Where I'm going to make my own phone.
He said he's going to make his own phone. He's like, I'll just make my own phone. You can't just do that. Like,
sure.
You can't just make your own phone, especially in a small amount of time, enough to capitalize on the PR of you getting booted. Like, it takes years to do this. He is going to get delisted, and he is going to fuck Twitter over. And on the way, he's like, fuck it. I'm going to take everybody down. He posts this. He said Apple charges a 30% surcharge. They indeed don't, Linz. And he's like, I'm going to go to war with Apple. Fuck it. And not only do they not do the surcharge, and I think you put it out in a pretty good post, if I'm not mistaken. That's a surcharge that
everybody
eats over $1 million, right? Is that
and he called it a tax. And again, he's just rage farming. It's a 30% service fee to people that gross over $1 million on Twitter or on the App Store. And that's for any developer. It has nothing to do with Twitter. It has nothing to do with you making a small-time video game or Cruise FM goes out and makes an app. They're going to charge them 30% for the, 20,000 downloads they get. It's for big players. That's how they make their money. But he's rage farming, saying, did you know Apple puts a secret 30% tax on everything you buy through their app store? That's bullshit.
Yeah. Fucking wild. You know what? Here's the thing.
Apple, let's go. Let's
when you guys have talked about Elon and so Twitter funny. and it's going to get turned off, and I'm like, no, it's not. It'll still be there tomorrow. When I get up tomorrow, it might be slower. He might fire a bunch of people. It might not be the thing that it was before, but it's not going. And that's the way my mind works. I don't like Twitter, but I don't hate him so much that I have to get off Twitter. And really, at the end of the day, who cares if Lochlin Cross makes a stand and goes, that's it, I've had enough. I'm canceling my account. No one is too flying about Lochlin canceling his account on Twitter. So it's all right, I'll just suck it up. But here's the thing. This is what I do. This is what I've learned when in this 52 years. I have learned something on this planet is if you really want to get disappeared, have an impact on the bottom line. And when money gets involved, that's when you're in trouble. Anybody who says in radio or in broadcasting, I got fired because I said this on the air. That's never the case. No, you didn't get fired because you said something on the air that upset somebody.
There were about 40 other things.
You got fired because somebody you upset pulled some strings for money. And they said, you're not going to get this money anymore. It had nothing to do with what you said. It had everything to do with the impact on the money. And yeah. So this I have, like, if Twitter goes away, it's because he's pissing off the people with the money. And the people with the money also have power to, like, deplatform him from their app stores and whatnot. So that's way more likely to me than any kind of disruption he can create from the inside out, right? Like, look at Trump. So, Trump's going to go away. Sorry.
No problem.
Trump's going to go away. He's never going to go to jail. He's going to go away because people are going to stop putting money in front of him. That's what's going to happen here, right? Like, that's the way.
I'm pretty sure he's going to go to jail. I hope he goes to jail. I'd still like to see it. But your point is a good one. Your point is a good one.
It is. Yeah,
the second you start fucking with the bottom line is the second you get everybody's attention. Now, Elon Musk hasn't figured that out because he literally thinks he owns everything, right? And so he thinks, because he's been able to push people around for the past 20 years, specifically for the past two, almost like 90% of his wealth has come from the last 2 years, by the way, just so you know. Mm-hmm. Like, he set himself up to the point where he's had a bumper crop. Like, he was like, you know, 108th 5 years ago, 3 years ago. He's number one with a bullet. He's got double the money everybody else does. It's just fucking crazy, to your point.
It's also
but he's acting lost. Like a kid who's like fucking high on Fun Dip all the time, right? Mm-hmm. Like, that's what he's acting like. It, like, is the fights that he picks, it's like, you know, fuck it. I'm going to say this. I'm going to do this. And he's got a whole bunch of people behind him going, don't do it every day. And now what he's doing is something that I find to be fucking unbelievably funny, right? He's treating Twitter like it's his own personal blowhorn, and he's making up the rules as he goes, and he's deciding who gets platformed and who doesn't because it's his and he's said as much, correct? Mm-hmm. Now, Apple can do the same thing, and he's saying, you can't do that. That is a sign of somebody who has no fucking idea what's happening. It's like, no, you've demanded this for yourself. You're employing this for yourself. It's all about you against the world. You get to make the rules, and everybody has to give you $8. You troll people like that all the time. It's like, you can fucking do what you want here, but you got to give me $8. He's delisted all kinds of people. He shut down accounts that hate his guts. He has shut down people that are posting videos about their Teslas where the doors don't work. He's literally taking, and when you ask him why, he's like, because it's mine. I can do what I want. And then he's like, I can't believe Apple's doing this to me. I'm like, dude, it's the same thing, but it's over there. Like, you don't understand that? Like, are you that fucking stupid? And he's not that stupid. That's the thing. He's that duplicitous. Like, he just doesn't give a fuck. And the fucking funny part is all the Elon Muskovites out there that are like, he can do no wrong. They're like, yeah, man, why do they do that? Meanwhile, he's doing that to everybody else right now at the same fucking time. Right?
I don't see it, though. It's just like Trump. It's a Trump thing. Yeah.
Fucking wild.
Very Trumpian.
Yeah. I love the duplicity.
Did you hear Trump's comment in the leading up to the midterms?
No.
So everyone was talking about the red wave. So he weighs in, and I actually saw this clip. Now, I don't know. Maybe it was a deep fake. But I just saw it, and it just summed him up for me. He basically said, well, this is how this plays out. If we do well and we win back the House or the Senate or whatever the fuck it is, it'll be because of me. But if we don't do well, it won't be my fault. And he said that.
That's what he said about the election.
He said, he said that verbatim.
Yeah.
Right.
This is not the first time either.
Elon Musk has a dose of that too, right?
Yeah. That's a great fucking point. It's and you know what? There are like 8 billion, just over 8 billion. And we hit 8 billion last week, I believe. Congratulations. World, way to go. Choke yourself out. That's the best.
Yeah.
I thought for sure we were going to go down. Like, Mother Nature's doing everything we can. Just now we got scientists digging up fucking weird viruses in the Siberia. Did you see that?
No.
They got something called the zombie virus. Did you?
No, we see that lens? Zombie virus?
What? No, that's not the one I was. Now there's two. Okay,
French scientists. What? Zombie virus.
What are you talking about?
Google it. Like, dude, we're all just gonna die. Like, I Mother Nature's doing everything it can. We're just we're literally a virus.
We are a virus.
Virus.
Oh, we are. We are. We multiply. We get.
I know
sick,
I'm
kill
stealing
things.
That
we,
from the yeah. Matrix, but yeah. I, it's honestly, true though. We, it's so true, and I have been saying this for years now. That anytime this stuff comes up, that anytime anything new or like cold
disease,
getting new disease, you get infections now. There is zero treatment for. Like, there's just so much about what Mother Nature's doing just to try to rid our numbers, just get them down just a bit.
Listen to this. Researchers from the French National Center for Scientific Research have revived more than a dozen prehistoric viruses that were previously trapped within the Siberian permafrost.
Why are we doing this? What are we doing?
Now they're going in there to see if there'll be a problem down the road.
From seven ancient permafrost samples, scientists were able to document 13 never-before-seen viruses that had been laying dormant for tens of thousands
of
years.
Have they not watched Jurassic Park?
Wuhan, anyone? Wuhan? Like,
in 2014, the same researchers unearthed a 30,000-year-old virus trapped in the permafrost. The discovery was groundbreaking because after all that time, the virus was still able to infect organisms. Oh, my God.
Well, a bunch of people up in Siberia died, too, because they're digging around up there with their fucking pickaxes.
Now they've beaten their own record. They said these viruses they've uncovered, 50,000-year-old viruses. What the fuck are we doing? There's a reason that the Earth went extinct every fucking 10,000 years. It's because of this stuff. Yeah. They're bringing
it back. Because of stuff like this. And you know what? Always the French.
You're right. It is. Scientists are thawing out these ancient viruses, they say, in order to assess the impacts on public health, Lachlan. As the permafrost, or permanently frozen ground, melts in the northern hemisphere, the thawing ice releases tons of trapped chemicals and microbes due to global warming. That irreversibly thawing permafrost is releasing organic matter, saying that this could be a problem. No shit. Yeah. Some of these, quote, zombie viruses could potentially be very dangerous to humans. In 2016, one child died and dozens of people were hospitalized in an outbreak in Siberia after they unearthed a dead reindeer carcass that was infected with a disease 2,300 years ago.
So I guess it's a good thing we're looking to get ahead of it if it's going to melt and show up in the drinking water. You know what I mean? Like,
oh, maybe. Stop touching stuff.
It's true. Just leave it alone. That's what happens when you pick up scab. It bleeds.
Quit digging shit up for fuck's sake. Yeah, leave it on the ground. It's there for a reason. Stop it. Yeah. Speaking of dead things, did you guys watch the end of the Emergency Act hearing last week? See the fireworks? See Brendan Miller get sued in the middle of his trial for lying about fucking outing some guy for being some kind of raging Nazi that was walking around with a flag when he was like the guy, he's like, that guy's name is Brian Fox. He works for Enterprise. Brian Fox, it's a big company. Brian's like, excuse me? I was in California. That's what you're talking about. So
that
he sued Brendan Miller, the convoy lawyer, right in the middle. Same guy, same looking dude, same size.
I was just going to say,
right, Encino Man.
Encino Man got.
Yeah. Speaking of don't touch things.
Long proven, 6 weeks. Basically, here's the end. I'll give you the short strokes. The convoy people lost. It was totally justified to trigger the Emergency Act. Justin Trudeau looked downright stately, even though I can't stand the man. And everything he said was backed up by receipts. So every convoy person lost last week. And they're going to get a decision coming up in the next couple months that says, yeah, the Emergency Act was totally justified. Go fuck yourself. That's just the end of it. It's just what happened. I'm not making it up. I put out a couple of videos this weekend. And I wanted to play this one for you because it garnered a little bit of interest. And then I want to get to what's going on with the convoy because the implosion has begun. But I put this out, and I wanted to see what you guys thought. RIP to the rest of the convoy.
Bedhead hearing. 'Tis the season. I've got my fucking scarf on. So the Emergency Act hearing is over. Convoy people lost. It's over. Done. Finished. You were exposed to be just a bunch of fucking losers. Your lawyers suck worse than you do. Holy shit, what a joke that was. Lawyers getting sued mid-hearing just because they're assholes that lie. Anyway, listen, that was a lot of fun. It was proven once again that there's no place for hateful horseshit in this country, and the convoy folks lost. That was a joke. It was an operation. It wasn't real. None of it was real. You guys just acted like assholes and tried to take over Ottawa, and it was proven that you guys are assholes who tried to take over Ottawa. So go get jobs. Go get vaccinated or not. I don't give a fuck anymore. Wear a mask or not. No one gives a shit. But you're going to wear that scarlet letter for the rest of your fucking lives. All the people that I know that went, scarlet letter. All the people that went that I don't know, scarlet letter. If you are at the convoy now, you're going to be seen as an absolute fucking pariah for the rest of your lives. And I'm here for it. Congratulations.
One thing I'm really happy about is that I stopped calling people names a couple months ago.
Yeah, yeah, you're doing really well with that.
It's been awesome to see your growth.
Mm-hmm. It's inspiring, actually, for others that want to grow. Maybe do you look to you as a beacon?
The thing
development.
Thank you.
Can I say this?
Yeah.
About where we're at right now with sort of the conclusion of this. I think a lot of people, whether you went or not, are under the illusion, and this is.
Are you going like to branch this? Are you going to olive branch
no,
this?
No, for, no, okay. no. It's not an olive branch at all. Are under the illusion that somehow that was a like a legal and a like legitimate protest. And see that the thing that I'm worried about is that because there is this overall perception that the convoy and that occupation of Ottawa or whatever you want to call it by some groups was like, well, what's wrong? They were just there. They don't like the government. They don't like being told to wear masks and the mandates, and it's their right. We're Canadians. The problem is that I'm not sure even this Emergencies Act inquiry did enough in regard to sending the message that there are steps to a peaceful protest. There are things that you need to do that even though we live in a democracy and yes, you are allowed to have an alternative opinion. You're not going to get caned in the street and put in prison because you don't agree with the leader of the country. Just because we live here that the convoy was on some level just a protest. That's the problem I have with how this thing all played out. I think they should have spent more time on, less time on, yes, we called this and this was that we had to do this, and more time on all the reasons and the steps and the things that they did wrong from a protest perspective. Because every day we talk about this, we get a group of people and there's about five or six of them that every day have a comment about how the rights and freedoms of Canadians have been stripped away as a result of this Emergencies Act inquiry. And that's just not the case. That's the unfortunate part about this. And not that these people were going to be convinced otherwise. A majority of them probably would never. They've already made up their minds on it. It's futile. But that's something I think, because we continue to protest. There's peaceful protests almost daily here in Edmonton, and they're legal and they're allowed. And as a Canadian, as somebody that lives in a democracy, I think it's important that we are allowed to voice our concerns, right?
Yeah, for three solid weeks, blocking traffic, making people go fucking insane with train horns, bus
horns.
I'm
not comparing
taking a shit in people's vestibules, you know, that kind of stuff.
Like this guy Donald and I have been going back and forth the last couple of weeks, right?
Yeah,
and I'm like, dude, there was a protest today about the human rights issues in Iran, right?
Okay,
it was downtown at the Ledge. I heard about it, and many Canadians went down,
mm-hmm.
like probably a couple hundred went down to actually protest what's happening to the protesters in Iran. That's legal. That's allowed. Canadians still have a voice. I just don't know if someone that is like convoy wired saw this Emergencies Act as anything other than just proving what they already think they know about this country.
You know, it's really nice that you approach it like that, because it's really kind of three things. Like, at the end of the hearing, these are my takeaways. It was a theocratic political opportunity that roped in some of Canada's dumbest fucks.
Mm-hmm.
It's kind of the bottom line. Where you say wired, like people that are wired to go to that country, what you're really saying is dumb fucks, in my opinion. That's just my opinion. These are people, by and large, and they found out over the past 6 weeks. The past 6 weeks was an absolute fucking undressing of all of their intentions, all of their lies about the tyranny and the dictatorship in this country. It was a love letter to themselves, that whole thing back in. And the only reason why they did it is they wanted to hurt the people of Ottawa, hurt all the Canadians that went and got vaccinated and didn't stand up for the rights of the unvaccinated. Well, fuck you. We all went out.
I think a lot of them. I don't think a lot of them went out there to get that because they wanted to hurt people. I think a lot of them were there because they love that victim card, Dean. They love that.
Oh, totally, totally. But they were, dude, but they were, how angry were those people that went there? They were angry. And if you ask anybody, and we had Tom Morazzo on the show a couple of months ago, and these were his words. I went there because no one was sticking up for us. So we wanted to let you know. We wanted to make you pay. That's kind of exactly what he said, if I'm not mistaken, right? Like, he's like, we wanted to make everybody pay for not sticking up for the rights of the unvaccinated. Again, go fuck yourself and your hat because everybody else did it, right? Like, we were all doing it, whether you liked to or not, whether you needed to or not. And it wasn't tyranny. Are you watching what's going on in China? Anybody seeing the videos in Wuhan, Beijing, Singapore, Guangdong province, where you got millions of people literally shaking buildings with their bare hands because they've been locked down for the zero
wearing COVID masks, thing. By the way,
all of them wearing masks because they're like, fuck, it's still got to be responsible. We riot, right? That's a protest. Those are people out there trying to fucking go. And they're, for the first time in that country's history since Tiananmen Square, they're going, fuck this country, right? Fuck them. And they're standing up for themselves. That's a dictatorship. This is not. Those people were allowed to fucking camp out for 3 weeks downtown
Ottawa. Now, do we have
fucking a month?
Do we have corruption in our country?
Huge. Absolutely. Of course we do.
Is the government in power right now? Are we gonna learn about things that this government did that's corrupt? Absolutely we are. Is the government that's waiting in the wings to take over? Are they corrupt? Are they doing shitty things? Guess what? Yeah, they probably are. But I will take what we have. That's where I have a problem with the discussion about where we're at as a society, because you get put in these camps and then you can't have a conversation about any common ground. And again, sometimes you are a little too far apart to even have a discussion. With Donald now, I just go, wow, things are so bad here for you. I really hope you find another country worth living in.
Isn't that amazing? Like, that's why I call all those cocks soft for so long. And it makes them crazy, right? When you call them soft too, where you're like, you're just fucking.
But here's the thing.
But they love. Hang on. Let me just finish that one point. Yeah. My one point is this, is that I watched the tweet machine go off all day. See people go, you know what? You're just into tyranny. I'm like, it's just a stupid catchword at this point. And when he's like, this is tyranny. And then the next video is a bunch of like Chinese military guys in hazmat outfits kicking the shit out of somebody for not being compliant. Right. Whole groups of people, kettling people. I've seen it and they don't even look at it. And so I instantly disrespect everybody in that movement because of that. Because we have examples to comparison shop of real tyranny and real dictatorship.
Yeah.
Like this wasn't it. And these guys are so fucking stupid, so fucking lost. And they lost. They spent 6 weeks losing. It was Loserville for fucking 6 weeks of that EA hearing.
But they don't see it.
Fucking arrested.
What's that? They see it as just another example of the of how the world doesn't work in their favor. Right.
Right. And that's the victim mentality. It's the ultimate victim industries. That those are the biggest victims in this country. And they all showed up at the same time because they're like, you're a victim. I'm a victim. Let's go be victims together because we don't know how to do life otherwise.
I tweeted that video you're talking about the Chinese guys in hazmat suits beating the shit out of protesters. And I've been tagging every couple of weeks. I tag Theo and Jamie and I just go, Penny, for your thoughts, just to sort of see if I've ever get a response. And I haven't yet. I haven't heard from either one of them. I haven't been blocked by either one of them yet, but I had one guy tag that thread with a tweet from a woman who lives in Ottawa, who apparently has a grandmother or some relative that's in the hospital dying, which is awful. I can't imagine. And she's like, this has just got to stop. I've got a relative inside there dying and we're not allowed to see them. And I said it out loud in the room at the radio station. And Jimmy goes, oh, they probably refuse to wear a mask.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's fucking on you. Cause guess what? Some hospitals are saying you still have to wear a mask. Guess what? You still have to wear a pair of pants. Like, get over it. Like, I guess. How is the mask more important than visiting your dying relative? And if it is, and you've made that choice, that's on you. That I'm sorry. These are rules. This is an institution. You're allowed to be in that building because they allow you to be in that building.
That's it.
And they perform surgeries and procedures where they want people to wear masks. And if you want to see Nana, who's passing away, put the fucking mask on, you idiot.
But what about me?
The scientists.
What is my rights? What about me, dude?
You come in, you want to see your grandma, everybody in here is wearing it. It's just a community thing. But what about me? That was all fucking, it's been 2 years of that. Like, are you guys not just fucking sick and tired? I'll tell you how tired of it I am.
How do you have any sympathy for that? That
I have none.
Zero. You can't.
Did you not see the video I just put out?
The scientist that discovered over 100 and whatever years ago that washing your hands saved lives and that you should wash your hands was put into a mental asylum because he was called crazy. And now it's common knowledge that washing your hands is part of your fucking hygiene. The same thing is going to happen when it comes to Western cultures adopting to a masking habit. Whereas in the Eastern cultures, they've been doing this for decades. It's not a problem. That's why nobody gives a fuck over there. They wear masks in the summer. They just don't breathe on me. That's gross. But these people just like to be breathed. Like, yeah, I love other people's breath on me. That fuck ventilation. I don't care about my kids in their classrooms. Don't put filters in. You don't need
how
that.
How does the mask this is, equate to this is tyranny? How stupid. You can't.
It's Danielle Smith. She just banned masks in schools for kids.
Oh, and now they're building triage. I noticed in Alberta, they're building triages out of mobile trailers outside of your emergency wards in Alberta right now.
It's bad.
And but you're not allowed to tell kids they have to wear a mask in school.
Well, and the thing is, I said it when we mandated it. I went, I understand why we're doing it, but I don't know. This is going to backfire on us. And then I said it when she put the rule in place. I'm like, this is dumb. If you don't see the hypocrisy of what you're doing, you were so pissed off that masks were mandated.
Yeah.
Now you're going ahead and you're mandating it. You're making it against the rules to mandate masks. Like, if you don't realize the hypocrisy of that, like, if you are so disconnected from reality that does not make sense to you,
you can't process.
Then there is no hope. Like, someone said, you lead Alberta. You're going to lead this entire province. If she is that dumb that she doesn't realize how demonstrably, like, I can't even speak. It just it incenses me.
The stupidity has that we have stifled people my
that dumb leading a province.
Yeah,
there's millions we have one of those people.
Too. Yeah, we have one of those too.
She's an unelected. She's an unelected leader, though. Let's
somebody still put her up there.
Yeah, she's a stupid conspiracy religious fuck. That's all it is. It's just a stupid conspiracy religious fuckery. Speaking of the religious fuckery. The good news is the Schadenfreude is here because it is shit-eating season.
Have you guys heard the audio of Tom Morazzo, our boy Tommy boy, quitting the convoy movement, telling BJ Dichter, the treasurer of the convoy, to go fuck himself? Have you heard this? It's over.
No.
Tom left
the haven't heard this, Lynn?
What?
Even I've heard this.
Oh. I've been in a hole. This is what happens when you disconnect for a couple of days. You come back and everything's fucking changed. They moved the couch. You can't find the fucking the
This is so great because it's like, if you want to know if it's a leaky ship, the guys who organized the thing that put a bunch of people in jail and destroyed a bunch of lives, gave everybody PTSD, are like, fuck you. You want the glory? You take the glory. Guys, glory. Like, you know what? You go fuck yourself, too. Like, it's literally like, let's listen to it. This is Tom and BJ Dichter. I like Tom. BJ Dichter, I would turn inside out in a conversation in about 4 minutes. I swear to God, I want 5 minutes alone in a soundproof room with him. He's such a joy
this,
boy.
Was this a podcast, Dean? Because I don't know.
It's
clip.
Like one of the convoy live streams. I have no idea, but why you listen? Like, it's a full-on domestic dispute with the organizers. They hate each other now. It's over. Okay. Watch this. Come on.
Okay, this is the pretty much the last thing I'm going to say about it. BJ, if you want all of the glory, all the attention, if you want it, you can have it. I gladly, whatever has ever graciously come my way, it's all yours. You can have it. I have never been attacked so much in my life by people that say they're on the freedom side than I have in the last 3-4 months since you got a bug up your ass about me. So take it. It's all yours. I'm out. I'm walking away from this shit. It's all yours, BJ. Good luck with it.
You did your job. You came in, you sabotaged us all. Great. Now go off into the sunset because you're not wanted. And you can take the piece of shit Keith Wilson with you as well. What a piece of garbage.
The next day.
Hey, everybody. Well, that's the end of it. The Public Order Emergency Commission ended on Friday. I'm still here, but I'm going to be leaving tomorrow morning. And I got to say, truthfully, I hate this city.
Another one bites the dust. Another one bites the dust. And another one gone. And another one gone. Another one bites the dust.
Come on. I thought you were joking when you used the word glory. Actually used the word glory.
Yeah.
Oh, that's an op. Fucking brilliant.
It wasn't real. The whole thing was fake.
You know what, though? I think the interesting thing about that for me is...
Hang on. Can we just fucking marinate on the whole thing for a second? How the two organizers are like, you want the glory? Fuck you. I'm out. I quit this movement. I've never been attacked so much in my life. By the way, Tom is a perpetual victim. If you haven't already figured that out, but everybody anybody that disagrees with him attacks him. That's why he was never sent to duty when he was a fucking guy in the army. They're like, you can't send you out there. You're too big of a pussy. You complain about fucking everything. Like, whatever. And anyway, long story short, he and BJ get into it. He quits, walks off the convoy, goes and records a video. He's like, I got to tell you, really fucking hate it here.
I'm going home. You know I don't have one. I'm going there.
But the thing for me is they got some attention. I think.
Well, man, hold it. Hang on. Understand this.
You boil it down.
Understand this. He got attention, but he lost his house.
Okay? Yeah.
He lost his jobs. He lost his income. He lives in a geodome. He lives in a tent. Yeah. In the woods,
and now he's got nothing.
Like he's got.
He's pigeonholed himself. It's from all the glory, and who the fuck is going to hire him? Give him credit. Give him a house. Rent him something. Like they do one Google on his name, and they go, "Oh fuck that, I'm out." Oh, buddy, welcome to your own island of fucking despair. Now you can be a victim because now you're a victim of your own fucking reality, you dumbass.
Yeah.
You can't write this. Dummy. It's the best. Oh, that's so funny. Now they're fighting. Guaranteed. I can guarantee you we're going to see violence in this group among each other at some point. Guaranteed.
Wow.
Whew. That was great, wasn't it? Can we watch it one more time together?
Yeah, just watch the end though. That licensed music is probably going to get us
licensing.
The voices you hear, are Tom Morazzo and BJ Dichter, convoy organizers. I want to know what they're on.
This is a podcast, or
I don't know. I want the whole thing though, because if this was just a snippet, I want the fucking whole thing.
I'd like to hear the whole thing too.
Yeah, I would too.
Okay, this is the pretty much the last thing I'm going to say about it, BJ. If you want all of the glory, all the attention, if you want it, you can have it. I gladly, whatever has ever graciously come my way, it's all yours. You can have it. I have never been attacked so much in my life by people that say they're on the freedom side than I have in the last 3-4 months since you got a bug up your ass about me. So take it. It's all yours. I'm out. I'm walking away from this shit. It's all yours, BJ. Good luck with it.
You did your job. You came in, you sabotaged us all. Great. Now go off into the sunset because you're not wanted. And you can take the piece of shit Keith Wilson with you as well. What a piece of garbage.
The next day.
Hey, everybody. Well, that's the end of it.
That's the end of it.
The Public Order Emergency Commission ended on Friday. Yeah. I'm still here. But I'm going to be leaving tomorrow morning.
Yeah.
And I got to say... truthfully,
I hate this city.
Another one bites the dust. So good. Very funny.
You know what? That feeling is mutual, Tom.
You know what? I think you can add Province to the list too. No one really likes you, bud. I feel sorry for him. I do. I don't feel sorry for BJ.
You just went through an entire diatribe before this about how you don't feel sorry for any of these fucks, and now you feel sorry for Tom.
Oh, I don't, but I do. Like, if I think about all the stuff that they've done, right? You're like, fuck you. I hope you never get a job again, and I hope someone comes to your place in March, and it's like, what's that smell? What's that smell? I think it might be Tom. Like, I'm okay with that, but I'm also, like, part of me is like, maybe you should get him a place to live for the winter, because it's going to be cold in that plastic tent. Like, it's going to be really fucking cold. It's been a mild one out here so far.
That's his freedom. He's got his freedom now.
Oh, my God. He is trapped. I mean, and it's like this for everybody, is it not? When you choose to go and act like this, you choose to go and change something that cannot be changed.
You just
handicap your entire life. And on top of it, I told Tom all of this would happen personally. I'm like, you're going to get abandoned. Like, this thing's going to break up. You're going to be left with nothing. And he's like, I don't believe you. And I'm, well, it's here, Tom. There you go. Congratulations.
The thing is, and this needs to be said out loud. And again, it's not, it seems so obvious to me. And I've told you guys about how to split up Canada. Like, you take half of the people based on their intelligence and you put them in one boat, like the dumbest people in Canada. Mm-hmm. And then you take the smartest people in Canada and you put them in another boat. Mm-hmm. I'm in the dumb guy boat. And so I don't understand why this is so easy for me to understand. Like, I know lots of people that didn't get vaccinated, that didn't destroy their entire lives over. Like, you chose not to do something you didn't have to do. You could, they still found a way to live, to make money, mm-hmm. to exist. They didn't have to completely destroy their lives. So it seems fairly obvious to me that the ones that are desperately needing attention, desperately need that victim card, desperately need to be a part of something and rally against something, like, for what? Because you think that the vaccine is their poison. Afraid. You think that somebody made money from it that shouldn't have made money from it.
Someone got more than them.
No,
yeah, that's exactly it, dude. It's like plug and play. It's like, what's my excuse to them? I'm gonna use that one. Big Pharma. I don't trust Big Pharma. Yeah, good one. This is Big Pharma day. And you know what? If you gave him a pill and you gave him a shot and you're like, after this, you can only tell the truth. Here's what they would do. Why didn't you get vaccinated? They go like this. I'm scared of needles.
I don't know about that.
I don't even think it's that. I don't think it's that desperately
need a cause. They desperately need something.
I'm afraid of needles and Jesus. If I get this, Jesus is going to be very mad at me when I die. And I just don't want to die. Go to heaven. That's all I want.
Let me ask you guys something. You guys know these people, like the people that we're dealing with. They're all the same. They all act the same. They have the same mentality towards anti-government. Very anti-authority, like no authority can tell them what to do. Have you also noticed that these people that you know in your real life, because you're not going to hear it from them out loud, but you know these people. Have you noticed that they're also the people that are the ones that would go on unemployment insurance in this winter, but have a cash job? They're also the ones that would fuck WSIB over. They're also the ones that they cheat on their taxes. They try to get ahead.
Handicap
they're
the ones that do a, on the
well, yeah,
on the caravan van.
They'll do a slip and fall in a McDonald's just to make $5,000. Yep. These are all, and this is what they've done for their whole life.
Their whole lives.
Somebody owes them something. And if they're not being given some, even when the government turned around and said, we're going to give you something to stay the fuck home. No, it's the government. I'm not taking that. Then when they get caught taking the CERB that they didn't deserve because they were still working, and then they get called out for it and have to pay it back, the government's fucked, man. Fuck them. They're always just trying to fuck me over. Fuck you. That's who we're dealing with here. Every single one of them.
Totally. The thing is, too, like this is something else that I think like on the other side of the equation, we all need to. Like I said earlier, I wish there would have been more emphasis put on why this protest in Ottawa or whatever you want to call it, occupation, mm-hmm. why it was unjust and why people, I wish there was more effort put on that. Like this was not a legal protest, everybody. They were not supposed to be there. They were, they tried to get them to do something that was more in line with how people protest in Ottawa. They didn't listen, and it went on and on and on and on. Okay. Now, here's the other thing. The other thing is, and this is something that I had a real problem with at the beginning of this, because it kept, depending on who you listen to or what information you were getting about the convoy and the people that were on their way to Ottawa. And I remember, and I'm sure you guys remember this, it wasn't even a year ago. It was 10 months ago. I kept saying, guys, this is not 25 people in a group, like stopping at a Tim Hortons every 6 hours from Lethbridge, Alberta on their way to Ottawa. This is bigger than you think it is. And this is something else that I think we need to all sort of like just sit on and just digest. Cause I keep hearing this number thrown around. It was only 8,000 people, man. I'll tell you, there was a lot of people that wanted to be there, but didn't have the nuts to go that would have, if they had one or two more situations in their lives had presented them an opportunity to go, and we would have more numbers there. This is a higher percentage of the population. And this is why I'm concerned about.
Totally disagree. Mm-hmm. I totally disagree.
So do I.
I agree with you that it's a small percentage of people.
It's still a small percentage, but that like it was only 8,000.
It was 8,000 the first weekend, maybe 5,000 after that, maybe 3,500, 4,000, depending on if it was the weekend.
I'm talking about the number of people that have convinced themselves that this government is a dictatorship, that we're living in a tyranny, that's
fine.
The numbers are higher.
That's fine. Yeah, they can say whatever they want sitting in their living room. That's fine. If you want to believe that you live in a tyrannical dictatorship from your living room,
and
you're not
out
shitting in people's streets and pissing in their vestibules, as Dean says,
totally love.
You're fine. That's the freedom of living here. That's why it's so fucking awesome to live in a country like Canada. You're allowed to believe that. You're allowed to say it out loud.
Yeah, but I think we should be concerned as a group of people that need to move forward with a common interest in that this is a fucking great country and that we're very lucky to have the freedoms that we do. I think we need to be concerned about the number of people that actually believe that this is some form of a dictatorship. I think those numbers are a lot stronger than the 8,000 that were there representing that group. And I think that's a problem. And I keep saying out loud that anybody on the left that is just automatically shits on that type of mentality or that type of thinking needs to look at the unintended consequences and the damage that's doing, because it's emboldening that group. And this isn't going away. It's eased off a little bit because we haven't got 8,000 people there for a variety of reasons in Ottawa honking horns and shitting in the streets. But it is still quite prevalent in the world that we live in today. We still have a lot of anger. It is. And I see what I'm concerned about. And you know what? And we can joke about it, but I think we are going to see more violence. I think we are going to see a situation where less and less people
They lost. They're going to get more violent. I agree with you. Like, that's what I'm saying. Is like,
I don't think that's a good thing, Dean. Well, I think we're going to see more and more people that are the good people that are not going to get into politics because of the risk that it potentially brings, which means it's going to thin that group, which means we're going to be left with less choice than we already have right now. And I think that we should all be very deeply concerned about that. And you know what? Nancy Pelosi's husband getting attacked in his living room in San Francisco. I mean, he was lucky that he basically, they followed their politicians around with a barrage of security guards down there.
Yeah, we don't.
Almost anybody, and we don't. I think we're way more, and I shouldn't even say this out loud. I think we're way more likely in this country to see somebody get very seriously hurt that's a politician. And we should all be very concerned about that, regardless of whether you like fucking politicians or not.
That's the freedom of living in this country, is not being afraid of that and knowing the reality of the fact that, yes, they're very angry and they get loud in a street corner. Canada's largest city right now is 25 people on a weekend with a fucking flag and a big fucking poster walking down Young Dundas Square. But 25 people out of a city of what? Four and a half million.
Yeah.
I'm not raising the alarm bells like that. That's an alarmist way of looking at it. You're right. It's something to be concerned. It's to be concerned about, I guess. We should address it and try to maybe redirect people in back to reality somehow.
Bring the temperature down. I think everybody on some level.
I just don't.
And I don't know. I don't. I know if we do that. I don't know if we do a very good job on the Dean Blundell podcast network.
Yeah, I disagree. I don't think we bring the temperature down. It's one of my favorite things to do is to troll these people, right? Like, you can't. And listen, I get in trouble for it from people that I work with, right? Yeah. Not trouble, but they're like, you know, do we want to kind of slow things down a little bit?
Smell in Tom's tent.
You want to slow things down a bit? And I think about it where, you know, there's days where I think we need to foster a more inclusive conversation about the losers from the convoy and us.
Again, we need a good job on the name calling.
We need
thing.
To, but I can't bring myself to do it. And I'll tell you why I can't bring myself to do it. Generally speaking, those people showed up, by and large, all the people that showed up for the fucking protest or the convoy showed up because they thought they were going to get a slice of $10 million worth of fucking GoFundMe.
That's like exactly it.
Like, they thought it was a paid operation. They thought they were going to get money, and that, like,
they were told they were going to get money. They were told they were going to get money.
All of them were. No one got a dime, and so they got mad. Right
now, and they lost trucks
at each other. Then they lost their trucks. Then they lost their licenses. Then they lost their cars. Then they lost their ability to work. A lot of them lost fucking bank accounts because it was fucking real. What we saw there was real. They got fucking bribed to show up. This is how fucking motivated and stupid these idiots were. They're like, we're mad at the government. And then this movement comes around. It's like, we got a slush fund of 10 mil. You want 10 grand? Come with us to Ottawa.
I think we'll they all deserve
your lodging. And they're all
get
like
what
this.
They got.
We've been locked in our house for about a year now. Let's go on a fucking road trip with a whole bunch of other trailer park tacos. Let's have a great time.
It was a great
time. Stop at truck stops. We'll see the rest of the country. We're out of our house. We're proving a point. We feel like heroes. We got community. What's not to love? I'll tell you what's not to love.
First time I felt relevant in my life.
Yeah, I've been a loser my whole life, and now I'm fighting somebody, and I found a community. And then, you know, the rest of the world, like the fucking the rest of Canada, if 8,000 people showed up, you had 35 million other people going, don't do it. It's a terrible idea. You're going to circumcise your life and handicap your opportunities. It's going to be a terrible idea. And they're like, no, we're getting paid. There's 10 million in a GoFundMe account. That disappears. They're like, we need more money. So they start a give, go, send fund. I post a link. with names. People get crazy. Death threats from guys that used to work in the White House because they wanted it to happen. And we outed the whole thing and they lost again. All they've done for 2 years is lose. They lost to POEC. They lost when they got cleared out. They're losing today because no one has jobs and homes and bank accounts. And after 6 weeks of this hearing, it's plainly evident that they're just a bunch of shitheads. Like, it's,
you know what the worst evident. Do you know what the That's worst it. Thing the I worst, know what the worst thing is. No, do you know what the worst thing that could happen to these people, Lachlan? Do you know what the worst thing is that could happen to them?
Yeah.
High school diploma.
Justin Trudeau gets voted out. You know why? Because they'll have nothing to fucking yell about. They'll have nothing to do. All of this goes away. If he was to something. If he was to do what he wanted and step down and resign, they would have had now what do you yell about?
No, Linz, what do? You clearly don't understand how motivated they are to find something to be angry about every day. They will. I think the biggest loss for all of us collectively, including that group, is there. And I think even you two agreed with me on multiple occasions. But we lost the ability to have this conversation because we got so, they did it to themselves. There is going to be no improvement. Let's say that fucking zombie virus that the French are digging up in Siberia fucking takes hold in a small town in Siberia. And then someone gets on a plane and heads to Germany and the fucking rest of us and the whole planet get the zombie virus.
Yeah.
And we have to shut down again.
Yeah.
We learned nothing. We learned nothing about what has happened and how to go about it and improve the situation. We're going to make all the same mistakes because we're so caught up in having a conversation about a fucking piece of paper on your face. And we're not actually having a conversation about the things that we did right and wrong in the shutdown and the way to improve those situations moving forward. We're never going to do it.
I think it's different. I think
we're never going to do it.
I know. You know what? You're right. They won't learn. They won't learn this time if, say, the zombie virus was to come. And you know what's going to happen? The one that actually matters, when the fire actually happens, when somebody pulled the fire alarm, the people that went, oh, it's fucking fake, I'm not leaving my apartment, and then they burn up in their apartment, that's exactly what's going to happen when it actually matters.
Yeah. Yeah, and they're persona non grata anyway. I mean, I don't take any one of those people seriously. If you're not, and it's not that if you're not vaccinated to want to wear a mask, do I take you seriously? No, of course I do. Are you a dick about it? Were you an asshole? Did you ruin someone else's day, week, or month, or winter? Did you yell at some? Are you one of those people? Like, it's the 8,000 that I'm centered at. It's not the 1.4 million that isn't vaccinated, or whatever that fucking number is. Or just some guy who's like, no, thank you, I don't want to wear a mask. Generally speaking, I could care less. I said that in the video. I don't give a fuck if you're vaccinated, don't wear a mask. I mean, that fucking ship has sailed months and months and months and months ago. It's a pointless conversation to have.
Can I tell you a quick story to sort of get us off track here? Because I think you guys will find this funny.
It's not a quick story, but you can tell stories. Quit saying about quick story.
It's about being yelled at.
Yeah. Stop lying to us.
Yeah.
And this is, I was shocked by this. And I very rarely do I have, like, I always have a snappy, like, I'm a pretty quick guy on my feet, eh? And especially if I think I'm right.
Like Fred Astaire.
Yeah. Especially if I think I'm right. So,
yeah.
You
got the best words.
I drop off my wife. I'm very articulate.
Yeah.
Put that in your word pipe.
Okay. Smoke.
So I drop the wife and my mother-in-law off at the parking lot to go into the farmer's market. And I have to go find a place to park. And I park, like, it's packed. I had to park way down, so I just walk, and I guess there was a bit of confusion, so they waited at the end of the parking lot for me, and I just walked into the farmer's market, and I'm wandering around looking for them, and I'm on my phone seeing if they're going to text me to say where they are. And I didn't know this, but there's one ways in the farmer's market. So there's old Locke trucking down the wrong way in the farmer's market. And some guy literally walks right up into my face and goes, are you fucking lost? And I'm like, what? I'm at the farmer's market. I got this guy with a fucking ponytail yelling at me. I'm not the only one walking the wrong way. There's lots of people doing it. We're angry. Like, people are just angry now. And I can't be the only one that's worried about it. I didn't even know what to say to the guy. I just went, no, I can't find my wife, though, I said to him. And then I looked down and I realized there's arrows and I'm going the fucking wrong way. The farmer's market.
Yeah, but that, you know what? The arrow that's people are the worst fun. People in the world. They're the same as the coaster people. Like the guys that go, hey, do you not see the arrows on the floor? That's where we're going, you fucking idiot. It's like,
yeah, but that's not a
government.
I know
that you feel terrible about yourself. You don't need to be the arrow guy for fucking self-worth here. Okay, fella, relax. Just because you know where I've got such a great life. I don't pay attention to arrows. I don't go where people tell me to go. Your life must suck so hard.
Guys,
you're the arrow guy at the
guys. It was
market.
IKEA did this to us. It's got nothing to do with pandemics. IKEA fucked us with the arrows.
That's another sim too. IKEA, another sim should be a whole game.
IKEA, I love IKEA, sim. But I don't ever just go there for a quick trip though. Like you need a full day.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, and you need to send you need like an evac crew just to get out of there. There's been days where I've sat down in the plant section crying, I don't even know how to get out of here.
Thank God these candles smell nice.
My wife legitimately said to me a couple weekends ago, we were in IKEA. I was started walking towards one section. She goes, don't go in there. I'll never see you again. Stay here. Yeah. She legitimately said that to me.
Like a child.
And it was the plant section. I was on my way to the plant section.
It's the worst, dude. You know how many times I've gone, oh, we'll just go through here and we should be at the front door. And I end up in like housewares. And I'm like, then it's like a circle. You're just walking around in circles in housewares. You're like, I think I've passed the tongs like 10 times.
Yeah.
And I'm now by the strainers again. And I just want to get over to where the plants are. Cause I know that's like, generally speaking, the plants are the last thing that you see in IKEA before you get into the warehouse, before you make your way to the cashier, before you leave. And I am not kidding you. Like do you guys get shopping sweats where you're like,
oh yeah.
You start getting anxious just cause you don't want to be there and you start sweating and you're feeling uncomfortable. What? Yeah, the shopping
IKEA?
Sweats.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
and I'm convinced.
The shopping sweats, and I always have to take a dump every time I go there, and I never.
Oh, I get that
nervous dump.
It's the colors.
It's that yellow and blue really gets you going, eh?
It's the colors. Same thing happens to me when I go to a McDonald's. I don't think I've been in McDonald's in the last 20 years without shitting. Like, it's the yellow seats or something.
I know what you're saying, though, Dean.
It's not.
It's the yellow. It's something.
Having,
I
like
just
having a dump trigger. There are stores that are just total dump triggers. Yeah, it's weird.
Yeah. McDonald's. And that one, maybe it's the meatballs. I don't know. It's something. You can smell the cinnamon buns or
I don't know
what the fuck is going on. But you're right about the walking around housewares and you pass the colander four times. Yeah. I'm convinced it's some Harry Potter fucking voodoo that you actually have to pick that colander up and it'll open a new pathway.
I think
and you
so.
Can now all of a sudden
Grant was telling me, have you guys heard of this? Maybe somebody will know in the comments. There's some show on Netflix right now where it doesn't matter where you start watching. And it's kind of like a choose your own adventure show, but depending on how you watch, it'll give you a different ending every time. Have you heard about this?
No,
no.
Yeah. I'll do some research and I'll bring it back.
Yeah. That'd be great. Yeah.
Was he high?
Are you Grant,
No. I haven't been stoned.
Just in the middle of talking about IKEA, you're like, you guys hear about this choose your own Netflix adventure?
That I know nothing about?
Like, and we're all excited. Like, we're like, yeah, tell us about it. And you're like, I don't know anything about it. I'll come back tomorrow and figure it out.
Thanks, Jimmy.
Honestly,
Jimmy does.
Yeah, just totally. No, you made me think of it when you talked about picking up the cauldron. Mm-hmm. And opening up a secret doorway in IKEA. Apparently, that's the show. Anyway, we'll leave it at that.
All right. Thanks, dude. Appreciate you guys being here. It was a fun show. Good to catch up again. It's been a few days. I needed the break.
Yeah. It was good to see you guys, though.
Great Thursday guys, was too. My fault.
Yeah.
Friday was Dean's fault.
Well, it's no fault. We can take a day off. Like, we don't have to do this every day. We do this, like, all the time. I haven't taken a day off in fucking years. So I'm like, fuck it. I'm going to take a day off.
I took
2 days off. Relax.
Then I hear about it sometimes. I always laugh. I'm like, well, just put in your application for your refund for the subscription and let us know and we'll send you the money back.
That's right.
That's probably why I feel like saying, hey, like this, because man, I take heat.
Like, yeah, same here.
Do one of these, man. They're on me like big time. I got about 10, 15, 20 people that are like, what's up? Where are you guys? Are you guys okay?
Dean? That's why we try to put an announcement out if we
Hallmark
can.
Movies?
If
four of them.
We know
we'll put out a thing, but sometimes if we don't actually announce it like we did on Friday, holy fuck, the DMs go crazy.
Well, I even told people that you back, you took the day off yesterday, you back Friday. Yep. And then I called Dean about 30 minutes. He goes, we're taking an E.
Yeah.
I went off.
Okay, yeah.
I'll send you the fucking complaints then.
Well, it's funny. It's funny too, because I got a ton of DMs from people and tweets and texts from people. It's like, where's the show? And I'm like, yeah, don't worry about it. Like, you don't care, right? They're like, no, we like it. And I'm like, for real?
It does feel weird. That is a weird thing.
It's, what do you mean? Like, you want it? You want us to come back?
I don't watch that.
I just assume people, we were just like an interruption in their day. And it's like, no, we like it. And I'm like, all right, well, I'll try and kick five out for you next week. But I'm taking time off at Christmas. All right.
We'll do five. We'll do five this week.
Five this week. We're going to nail it. Tomorrow, we've got a special show, by the way. Just a recap. Kenny and Spenny from Kenny versus Spenny will be here. Not just Spenny this time. Very Kenny good. Is riding shotgun. We're doing a 4 o'clock show. It'll be all of us with Spenny and Kenny talking about their Christmas shows. And I'm very excited to pimp these Christmas shows because they do the same show at Christmas that they do in July. They just put Christmas clothes on. That's all they do.
No, actually.
That's what I heard. I heard they're going to do a full-on Christmas rectal exam on the stage.
No.
I'm going to
you know what
Hamilton.
I heard?
I'm going down to Lynn's. I'm going to go see the show with Lynn's and Hamilton. Yeah.
We're
gonna
have
fun. You know what I heard? I heard that because Spenny, we told Spenny that we are going to just, we're hijacking the show and that we're just going to do a Locker Room Presents, whether he likes it or not.
Like you did with Tom Segura.
Bert Kreischer's show is just unofficially presented by the Locker Room. So I told him we're doing that. And I said, give us some tickets to give away. He's like, what? No, what are you talking? I don't even want you guys to sponsor the show. I'm like, what? Why? Spenny's hilarious.
I told him I was going to come see him in Hamilton. So I was texting with him today because he's supposed to be on today. And he goes, no, I can't. My kids. And can we do tomorrow? And I'll bring Kenny. And I'm like, yeah, sure. No problem. And I'm like, just need to make sure we have a couple of tickets because I'm going to go come down to Hamilton, might go to the one in Toronto to see Kenny versus Benny. And I'm like, make sure you put me on the guest list for both of those shows. And he's like, no, you got to pay like everybody else. I'm like, fucking serious? Dude, yeah. I'm like promoting your show. He goes, yeah, but you can afford it. And I need the money. And I'm like, all right, sure. I'm going to give you $50 to pay for the tickets.
That's it.
That's by the way, it's never happened to me. By the way, where
I need to figure,
like,
we need to figure out
to my
how many
show, and I'm like, sure, and he's like, it's gonna be $80. I'm like, all right. Mm-hmm.
By the way, we need to figure out how many tickets we need for the New Year's Eve show, because you're coming out,
yeah,
and then my family wants to go, because I mean, there's an outside chance Gordy will throw me up on stage on New Year's. So, are you bringing anybody?
I don't think so. Maybe.
Okay. Well, let me know if that changes.
No, I don't think all so. Right. I haven't talked to anybody about it. Like, it's just me coming in and out. Coming in.
Okay. All right. Anyway, here's the thing. The Kenny versus Spenny shows, I don't want to downplay this because I think they are going to try something different. Because what they're talking about is, and I don't know if they've worked it out yet, but they might try to get people from the audience to do the shit that they used to do during the instead of the two of them doing it. They might pull a handful of their stunts and go, all right, anybody in the crowd want to do this from season 4?
The teabagging with the Bears?
Well,
the bat
right,
wings.
There was some fairly offside stuff they did, right? Like, from
Spenny shit himself in like every second episode. So we're going to have some of that. Like, then there's the episode where they had to like the contest and the guy who had lost it to get repeatedly teabagged by a couple of bikers. Like,
so this is interesting. This is a different angle, right? So,
well,
I mean, and
Spenny
also
was really high on acid and a whole bunch of PCP during that show too, a couple of times. So
he's going to get mad that I said that.
Why? We all knew it.
We say it every time he's on.
That's the only thing I want to talk to him about is all the bad shit he did. I'm like, tell me about the time you got dressed up like a KKK guy. He's like, no, I don't want to talk about it.
I
really
want to
talk about my music. Hey, did you smoke
CBC?
Crack?
Me neither. Like, if you, there's shows like that where you watch Kenny versus Spenny and you're like, I can't believe they got away with this on cable television for 10 years.
Six years they were on CBC.
Stuff was like, they're allowed to like when we look back at shows, like in 20 years from now, we'll be so fucking politically correct. They'll come looking for Kenny and Spenny's kids.
Yeah. Well,
that woke and, crowd. They
yeah,
will.
Yeah.
It was stat well, offside, but it was fucking brilliant.
The thing about it too is, I mean, this is how you know about the how bad it was. They were on YouTube for years, and then even YouTube eventually was like, "Why is this on?" And they yanked them. So now they're like, "You can't find this stuff anywhere."
So they fly around.
Yeah, they
different.
He got rid of his YouTube. They canned his YouTube channel. Like yeah. it was yeah. his own stuff. Like they actually, he had hundreds of thousands of people that were following that channel too, which was really.
And he
sad.
Doesn't care, which is
I know
real. Like I would Crazy. Be furious. Anyway, yeah, Same. I'm coming. But we'll talk about that, and we'll talk to Kenny and Spenny tomorrow, right That's here on awesome. The show, 4 o'clock. That is Locked and Cross 957 Cruise FM.
I'm going to the Edmonton Locked show, Cross whether fucking Spenny wants it or not.
Do you want me to come
we're
to
sponsoring
that
too? It? You, no, you, just Can come for New Year's.
All right.
That's a lot of Dean. That's a lot of Dean. That's a lot of
no. We're gonna have no. You'll love me.
We're gonna have Edmonton in January too, Dean. Just so you, I don't even know if you're aware of this one yet, but Fire for Effect Army Chris is coming out mid January.
Here
to yeah to Ontario. So yeah.
A little cooking?
You're doing a little cooking. We're gonna do a little bit of cooking. He's gonna come by. We'll probably hit you up see if you wanted to grab a.
He DJ'd our Christmas party for some fucking strange reason. Just randomly, Army Chris DJ
for Cruz.
DJing.
For
did
Cruz.
You? Did you have your Christmas
so
party this weekend?
Fucking bad. He was like, every once in a while, every like 5 to 6 minutes, I would turn around.
A lot of kid rock.
Right, right, right. No, he was trying to. He tries to scratch, and he doesn't know how to fucking do it.
It's so white.
You had
He's
Army
so
Chris
white.
DJ your wedding, and he doesn't
yes!
know how to DJ.
You can't even make it up. You can't even make this shit
Did
up.
Did you have oh, your staff Chris. Christmas party this weekend, by the way?
Yeah.
Did you get drunk?
So,
free booze?
I'll tell you a quick story.
Oh, yeah, yeah. yeah. It's not quick. Quit saying quick story. Just say I'm telling a story. Stop saying quick. It's never quick.
Okay, so
it's very disingenuous.
We found out our yeah. new head of programming is new. Like he just, the guy that was doing it before, he retired, he quit, and he said, I'm not doing this anymore, and they gave it to a new guy. And literally he's been doing it a month, maybe 2 months. So we find out he sends us a note and he says, hey guys, love to get together quickly on Friday. If you have a few minutes, I'm coming into town on the 25th, blah, 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 and I'm going to stick around and go to the Christmas party. And I'm like, oh shit. Like you have no idea. I can't even start
Full
to
dose,
explain
Jimmy.
The debauchery that goes on at our Christmas party. It is full.
Yeah, doesn't
it,
Jimmy strip at your Christmas parties usually?
Every year. So, and no one knows. I know our head of programming. I've known him for years because I've been doing this a long time. So I get a sense of who he is. But I mean, I don't know him that well.
Right.
So we do an intervention late last week before the Christmas party with Jimmy. And I'm like, Jimmy, you can't go full Jimmy. You can't do that to this man. And he's like, I know. And he legitimately has a plan in place. Like he's not going to pre-drink. He's got a place to go to after the party. I said, come, you need to come to the Christmas party. Everybody would be wildly disappointed if you don't show up.
For
you
sure.
need to have a couple of drinks. You need to have a dinner, but you need to make an exit stage left. You can't do full Jimmy. So we get there, and I was actually pretty proud of the little bastard. He was maintaining. And then I don't know what happened. A switch went off, and he brought full Jimmy out. It wasn't even 10 o'clock, and he was just like...
Well, he goes zero shirt to fuck off. Like that.
What do you mean? What's full Jimmy though? Like shirt off, nude, dancing, stripping, little fella, that kind of thing. Grinding, drinking, shots. Okay, yeah.
yeah
just,
he
got in his head.
He rubbed up on a coworker.
Nice. Nice.
Another coworker went to grab him, and he's a heavy little bastard. Went to pick him up, and they both fell.
Yeah.
Jimmy's got a big gash on his face from falling. Like it was just a I saw it when I went to the bathroom. I came out. I drank my 4 free drink tickets. So I was like, all right, I'm looking at getting out of there. And I was thinking about bringing Jimmy with me. And so I walked back to the table and Jimmy is sitting there at another table close to the one we were sitting at. And he's got his hands up on the table and there's 40 shots on the table. And there's like five people standing around. And I'm like,
did someone get his head?
I don't know.
Army Chris must have gotten his head.
No.
That sounds like him.
Army Chris was so worried about scratching John Cougar Mellencamp that he wasn't paying any attention to keeping dibs on Jimmy.
It was ditty about Jack and Diane. Two American kids growing up in the heartland.
Four or five videos.
Football star.
That's right. There was about four or five videos of just complete it. If anything, that group, we got heavy drinkers in our building. I don't touch a lot of these guys. No. I don't even touch any of them. They went full blast. Drinks were $3.
Yeah.
Drinks were $3.
Exactly.
And you got your primers for free.
Yeah. And yeah, and you got your primers for free. And Grant went home with $100. Is that tab was $100.
And drinks were $3.
And drinks were $3. That's and he passed out at 11. And Grant is a Grant's a big boy and a really, I don't think I've seen too many people out drink Grant. And the fact that he passed out at this is a sign of how bad it was.
But you know what people do when they go to those Christmas parties? I used to do this all the time too. Well, I didn't because I made a lot of money. But there were people that didn't, right? You go to a Christmas party and they're like, I'm going to get as many of these fucking free drinks in me as I can.
That's
right. And I'm going to get as drunk as I can. And I'm going to take out all my frustration from the past year working for these assholes at my Christmas party.
Yeah,
that's exactly what happens. It's like, you know, employees that like a lot of employees that work at big companies that have Christmas parties where you get four drink tickets. That's full resentment. And not only are they going to drink those four drink tickets, they're going to have seconds at the lasagna bar. They're going to
steal the poinsettia.
They're going to steal the centerpieces because they're like, you know what? Fuck these guys. They cheap out on me 12 months of the year. They throw me one party, give me four beers. That's their way of saying thanks. No, man. Staff Christmas parties is just drinking resentment.
If you're a good and responsible human being in the society, it is your job at that point to give them at least one or two of your drink tickets. Every single other person, and make sure they have a big stockpile, and then sit back and watch the show because that's what you deserve this year.
Locke, you can't tell me that that's not how you've treated Christmas parties in the past, full of resentment, where you show up and you're like, my boss is a fucking prick. I'm going to get 12 alarm hammered. I'm going to drink a bunch of their free booze. I'm going to take as many door prizes as I can home with me and say, fuck it. At least I got something out of the experience.
I've never had a lot of resentment. I have resentment after I leave, generally speaking. I'll tell you what happens with me. Here's the thing. I don't need booze in me to tell you what I think. I've always been that guy that's pretty honest. And what I find is everyone is just, and it's even worse now with millennials. They spend all their days just trying to tell everybody what they think everybody wants to hear. So that resentment, the fact that you brought that up is beautiful because that's what I see on a fairly regular basis. So the problem I have with Christmas parties is these people that are normally just trying to say the things that they think need to be said in order to, I don't know, make life more comfortable for them and just keep blasting through, you know, life with no consequences. They end up getting a couple of drinks in them and then the tongue loosens up. Then they start to say the things they really want to say.
My favorite part of the evening.
And that's why I leave before 10. Every time.
You're crazy.
The last thing you want is a Lochlin who doesn't have a problem telling the truth when he's sober with four or five free drinks in him. Add that to the list of people that are now all of a sudden they've got a couple of drinks in them and then they get to start.
Why
saying,
are you leaving? That's when the fucking fun starts. When people
that's
get
it.
The courage in them and they're like, I'm going to go talk to the general manager because he just cocked to me in the bathroom 3 weeks ago. And I'm going to tell him exactly what I think of him. And you fuck yourself.
And
Jerry, fuck yourself and your dumb
that's
wife.
Exactly.
Right. I would be feeding you. I would be feeding you the tickets. I'd be like, you know what? You're right, man. You shouldn't take that here. Well, grab another drink before you do though. Take those tickets. Act like admission.
We had that head of programming. Has a pretty decent sense of humor, but he's at the bar. And the only reason I know about it is he's at the bar chatting with Grant. They're having a cocktail and it's not even 9 o'clock. I don't even know if we've eaten yet. And one of the sales girls comes stumbling up, just shittered already. Like it got really ugly fast. Like I was shocked at how fucking out of hand.
It's Edmonton,
it was early.
Right. It's Edmonton. Yeah. It's radio. But it's a double double right there.
Yeah.
It's like you can times it all by four. All of it.
So she walks up to him and she's like, "Who the fuck are you?"
Not even mad at him, just a general bad
and he
drunk.
Laughed.
That's because, my favorite.
Oh, you know who he is, Dean. He just sort of chuckled.
Jimmy McCourty, he's a great guy.
Yeah, he's just like, oh, I'm the head of programming.
Yeah.
What's
yeah.
your name?
did she get embarrassed?
Fuck are you? Yeah.
Oh, dude, I think there was a lot of people with their heads down,
right,
today.
Where someone gets a whole bunch of cocktails in them, and you're like, that's what I love now, because I don't drink. So when I go to places like that and I go to parties, I'm like, I fucking love moments like that where the drunkest chick in the place walks up to the host of the party and is like, your wife has Botox. I'm like, yes.
Dude, we did that. We've done this. Remember when we went to the Danko Jones show? Neither of us were drinking, and we just kept feeding our free drink tickets to our friend to watch him get drunker and drunker and drunker. Yeah. And then he threw up on the 407 on the way home. Like, we did this on purpose.
He's like, I never get out. We're like, here, have our drinks. He's
here,
like,
have one, another one. I'm driving. Dean doesn't drink. So it was perfect. Yeah.
So he's just driving home and he's like, guys, you're going to have to pull over. I look at Lynn's and I'm like this. Yes.
Yes.
You know what? I'm not complaining about our party, because in this business now, well, you broadcast in a lot of companies, there's like, doesn't it's not even broadcast. There's no such thing as a Christmas party. So we're lucky to have one. Yeah.
Yeah. You are. Radio,
but I
have a lot of friends in radio and they're safe. Like, we haven't had a Christmas party for 4 years. It's just like,
I play it safe. And I usually exit every year. I exit early. You know what? I get stupid and drink and at staff functions enough during the year. I don't need to do it at the Christmas party when everyone's wearing, you know, glitter.
Ugly sweaters and glitter. Yeah. And there's lots of pictures.
We had one guy that had a rough weekend because he just started like literally a week ago. Like, and then got to the Christmas party and just got tanked.
Did he overdo it? Did he go way too hard? He
Who's the new guy?
New guy, don't ever do that. Your first Christmas party, if you're the new guy, go light. Hammered when you get home.
He did. Anyway, he got hauled into a meeting this morning from what we could tell.
Oh shit.
He was chewing on it. He's the one that picked up Jimmy. Jimmy hates being picked up.
See?
Right? Don't pat him on the head. But I mean, here we go. We
density of a dying
Jimmy.
Sun.
Like, we got shirtless Jimmy stripping for another coworker.
Yeah.
And then the guy, the new guy, gets in there and picks him up and then falls. And then he's in trouble. And I'm like, well, there is a little bit of irony here, right? Like, the guy that picked him up and they fell is in trouble. But the guy shirtless stripping for a coworker, we're all good with that.
Who was grinding on the promotion chick's leg. That's fine. Jimmy's got seniority. He's allowed to do
like
that.
A Bichon Frise.
But here's the other thing I said to Jimmy, because Jimmy always, I always get a call after every Christmas party. Look.
What happened?
Like everything, too far? I'm like, save it for Monday. Click. The thing with Jimmy, though, is, because I like it when he stews on it and he sweats it all week. All weekend. So then the break is even funnier on Monday when we go back about how, hey, you remember the intervention on Thursday? Where we told you, you know, maybe don't strip at this year's Christmas party.
I caught the front end of your show this morning, and that's exactly what it was. You even teased him in the beginning. You're like, we're going to talk about that after this. You could hear it in his voice. He was so anxious.
He is just anxious all weekend. Yeah. But I mean, Jimmy can get away with it. Like, because Jimmy's Jimmy. Everyone loves Jimmy, right?
True.
I mean, and he gets coerced into this shit, right? You know, it's not really, I'm not taking away the blame here, but people are going to the Christmas party with the expectation that he's going to get shittered. And at some point he's going to rip his clothes off and we're going to have a little. Last year, they had him on a table and they were doing shots out of his belly button. I swear to God, I come out of the bathroom.
Well, where do you, dude, then he can do whatever he wants at every Christmas party for the rest of his life then.
Yes. So, yeah. So the fact that the guy, but it I is do that and I'm in HR.
It's not fair. I'm sorry. No. It's not fair.
The logistics business is crazy.
I'll tell you
what happens at those Christmas parties.
Yeah, I bet.
I worked at the Pan Pacific Hotel, and we had parties. We had big groups come in, just and kidding. I'll tell you, the worst every year. Teachers, my God, they made the cops look bad.
Cops are brutal too. EMS.
No, teachers are way worse, dude. I was at a Christmas party several years ago.
They're crazy.
Where two teachers. This is like a local Christmas, and we were just upstairs at the pub, and there was these teachers from an elementary school. Right. Mm-hmm. I was there with like three of my friends. This is years ago. And one of them walked over to my friend, hammered out of her mind. She's like, I want to SUD in the bathroom. And I'm like, aren't you an elementary school teacher?
She goes, yeah, it's Christmas my kid.
Party. There's no kids here. And I'm like, all right, are you going to go do it? My buddy Greg's like, I don't think so. I think I'm good. But thank you very much. She's like, all right, if you want one, I'll give you a greasy one in the bathroom. And I'm like, what the fuck?
Oh.
And then 20 minutes later, she came over with a friend and offered my other two friends blowjobs as well in the bathroom downstairs at this pub. And I'm like, what the fuck?
Did you guys run out of drink tickets?
I just need to add that to the list of shit that's never happened to me before.
You're the wrong radio station, apparently. I was at one with EMS, fire, and police. I think I've told the story on the show where you were standing there and you had a drink in your hand. It was like a corn boil, big corn fest thing. And all of a sudden your arm drops dead. Your drink's on the ground. You're like, what the fuck? I can't move my arm. There's a paramedic beside you with a thing of xylocaine. And he just kind of hits you with it in the elbow and your arm's dead for the night. Like, and then they're laughing at you. Like, oh. I'm like, you motherfucker, like you're a paramedic. Like, what if I'm allergic to you? Because no, you're fine. It's fine. We've got EpiPens and shit. You'll be okay. Best fucking people to party with ever.
EMS people?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. My God.
Yeah, dude, absolutely. I party with an EMS guy that literally put an IV drip in his arm before he went out so he could literally hook himself up when he got home and not have a hangover in the morning.
Yes.
No word of a lie.
Smart move.
Yeah. And I'm like, do you do this all the time? He goes, every weekend. I'm like, where do you get the bags of fucking saline? He's like, oh, I steal them from work. I'm like, that's a fucking good drinker right there. Right? Yeah, but he's got it all figured out. Anyway,
yeah. Yeah. Great party.
Why do you think nurses do 12-hour shifts?
Just so they can steal IV bags and not have hangovers after they go out to the club.
So good.
Anyway, thanks, right, boys. Appreciate it.
Good to see you guys.
Lachlan Cross, 957 Cruise FM in Edmonton. You can listen to him every single weekday morning, 957cruisefm.ca. Follow him on Twitter, at Lachlan Cross. He just pieces right out, too. He doesn't even wait,
wait for us to say goodbye.
It's unbelievable, yeah.
Such a big dick move.
That it is. He big dick. That's Ryan Lindley. Sheeple Shepherd Podcast, The Lens Report. Download, subscribe, both. You can also follow him on Twitter. Great to see you, brother.
Good to see you. See you tomorrow.
You got it. That's Ryan Lindley, and that's it for us. Have a great day, everybody. I want to thank our friends over at cantorque.com. Looking for some industrial wrenches? Everybody is. Seriously. It's a whole world I didn't even know existed until we started doing business with these guys, and they're unbelievable. Canadian company. They make industrial tools. Canada's assembly tool experts, making rugged, hardworking, beautiful torque wrenches. Canada's leading industrial tool experts, offering you the very best in sales, service, rentals, calibration, maintenance, and custom fabrication of industrial torque tools. No matter the scale of your bolting project, they have your solution. Go to cantorque.com today. Canadian company, Canadian manufactured tools for real industrial tooling solutions, looseners, fasteners. You all know what I'm talking about. Mining, tech, nuclear. I mean, the applications for that kind of stuff is crazy. Towing. Dude, I mean, it's a whole world that nobody here understands except these guys at Cantorque. And they manufacture everything in beautiful Edmonton, Alberta. And it's a Canadian company. And they brought manufacturing back to Canada. So cantorque.com. If you're looking for any more information or if you have a need for real rugged, hardworking, beautiful torque wrenches, they are Canada's leading industrial tool experts at cantorque.com. Also, hi to our friends at kivlaw.ca. Listen, this is these are a group of defense attorneys that actually give a crap about human life and human freedom. Seriously. I've learned a lot just from being in business with these guys. Kivalod.ca, defense lawyers, Southern Ontario, that help you get out of trouble. If you're in it, it's your problem, or if it's not your problem, you're accused of doing something you didn't know you did, or if you made a mistake and you want to get out of that mistake and get on with your life, this is always your best bet. My friend Rob Kivlikin at Kivalod.ca, email address robert@kivalod.ca. Get in touch with him today. Send him a note and say, hey, let's get together because I got a legal matter that needs clearing up. And his team is the best in the province. So if you're in Southern Ontario, you need excellent, outstanding, incredible legal representation. Go to kivalod.ca and check them out today. robert@kivalod.ca. That's your email address. And of course, Ed's Fine Imports, as always. Ed, you're the king. Really appreciate you doing this and being our friend and sponsor for the last 3 years of this podcast. Really two, because we've that's kind of been taking it seriously for 2 years. But he's been on board for like three. It's like our first client. He makes Canadian underwear. Gitch, G-I-T-C-H. Canadian branded underwear, boxer briefs, made in Canada by Canadians for Canadians. You can get a pair right now for almost nothing. It's super cheap. I think like $28 you get a pair of underwear for. And if you take the discount when you use promo code GITCH3 into account, you get like a free pair of underwear. So what does that knock it down? Another $30? Dude, you can't miss. Four pairs for the price of three. GITCH3 is your promo code. Boxer briefs, pouch in the front. Can't miss. If you're looking to send someone a gift for Christmas and you're like, ah, everybody needs underwear. Send some guy. Every dude appreciates a good pack of underwear for Christmas, especially if you're over the age of 18. They've got clothes for men and boys there too as well. Massive selection. Huge online store. But get Ed's Gitch, G-I-T-C-H. GITCH3 is your promo code. He'll send you a free pair. Free pair. How great is that? Send you a free pair of underwear and use promo code GITCH3. Canadian underwear for Canadian men. Have a great day, everybody. We'll see you tomorrow. Kenny versus Spenny. Both Kenny and Spenny will be here around 4 o'clock. So will we. So we'll see you then. Make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel, Dean Blundell Show on YouTube, Twitch, Dean Blundell TV, Apple, Google, Spotify, wherever you get your fine podcasts as well. Have a great day. See you tomorrow. Kenny versus Spenny will be here with us at 4 o'clock. We'll see you then. Bye.